Hey everybody, I want to remind you of the different ways that you could send your tithes and your offering. You could do it through texting. If you don't have access to Google Play or the App Store, just send a text to 601-273-4609 and send it to the word give. After that, you'll receive a text message back, and then just follow the simple instructions, the simple steps, and you're all set up. Also, you can use the Tidely app. Just download the app from the Google Play or the App Store, and you can set up the amount that you want to give, and you can send it to Springs of Praise Rural Outreach Center, or you can mail it to Post Office Box 549, Crystal Springs, Mississippi, 39059. If you want to drop it off at the church office, the office is open Tuesdays through Thursdays from 10 a.m. until 4 p.m. And as always, I want to thank you for watching this program. And Matthew 24:37. Yes. Well, mine's a little bit different, but I'll read it. When the Son of Man returns, he will be like, it will be like it was in the days of Noah. For as in those days, before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day when Noah entered the ark. Let's pray. Father, we just glorify you today. Father, I empty myself out to you, and I just ask that you fill me with your anointing, Father. Give me the words and the wisdom to share with your people, your children, your family. And Father, we just ask that you train us in a way that we're supposed to go in preparing for the end of ages. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, let's have a seat. As you can see, the title of my message is What the Rooster Meant for Evil, God is Going to Use for Good. Okay, for those that don't know, February 13th, I was blessed by a rooster spur to my knee. And so we're going to get into that a little bit, but that's the reason why I titled that. And he did have eyes like that, I'm telling you. He really did. He really did. But I wanted to back up a little bit in the scripture that we just read, because in the scripture we just read, it says, when the Son of Man returns, it would be like it was in the days of Noah. And then, of course, it starts giving you a whole list of what they're going to be doing in the days, what they're going to be doing, what they did in the days of Noah, we're going to be doing in today. And it was before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark. But I want to backtrack a little bit, because in Matthew 24:6, and it's not going to be up there, so I'll just read it. It says, and you will hear of wars and threats of wars, but don't panic. Don't panic. Yes, these things must take place. Okay, these things must take place. So there's nothing we can do. Okay, there's nothing we can do. These things must take place. But the end won't follow immediately. Nations will go against nations will go to war against nations and kingdoms against kingdoms. There will be famines and earthquakes in many parts of the world. Okay? Is it happening? It's happening. But all of this, only the first of birth pains. All right? So, I mean, this is the first contractions he's talking about. There will be more to come. And many will turn away from me and betray and hate each other. We're seeing this. Sin will run rampant everywhere. We're seeing this. And the love of many will grow cold. We're seeing this. But the one who, guys, the one who endures to the end will be saved. We have got to push. And I'm talking about push our faith, not push back. We need to push our faith. Our faith is constantly being challenged here. We need to endure to the end and we'll be saved. And the good news about the kingdom will be preached throughout the whole world so that all nations will hear it, and then the end will come. So I shared all of that because last year, I don't know, probably June or something like that, after my garden totally failed, my spring garden totally failed, and I got nothing. I started listening to some preaching, and in it, they were talking about this. You'll know that the end is coming because you're going to see this, and you're going to see that, and you're going to see this, and you see it. Do you see it happening? Yes, I see it happen. Well, you know the end's coming. But you can't prevent it. Okay, so I can't prevent it. So what do I do? You see it happen. You just got to get rid. Well, what do I do? And so I turned it off. I turned it off and I started praying. And I said, Lord, all this is coming. All of it's here. Every generation, and I tell Karen this all the time, every generation said Jesus is going to return on that generation. Every generation seems like it's the days of Noah. But something starts to happen, and other things start to happen. So he says, it's going to be like in the days of Noah. So, okay, Lord, what was going on in the days of Noah? What was going on? Everything. Sin ran rampant. People hated one another. Homosexuality was going crazy. It was just, the whole world was falling apart. And what else was in there? Well, there was a big boat, the ark. And then there was Noah. Okay, what else was in there? Well, then there was the promise of the rainbow. And so all of these things are going on as in the days of Noah. So I'm looking back, and I'm just like, well, I mean, you could say that World War I was like the days of Noah, but something was missing in World War I, so I guess you can't say that it was that time. And then World War II. And then you're thinking, okay, well, everything lines up with this in World War II, so this might be the end times as well. But something was missing in there. And then it just kept going on. And each event that's happened in our lives, which escalated more and more, Mount St. Helens erupting and just pouring itself all over the countryside. You're thinking, this is the end times. There's the volcanoes. There's the earthquakes. There's the tsunamis. All of this. But something was still missing. And so we get to our generation. And everything that you see that's happening right now is biblical. But the thing that was missing in all the past has finally come forward in the form of the rainbow. We're now seeing the rainbow.
Yeah.
But what they've done to the rainbow.
Right.
What is the word that I want to use? They have polluted the rainbow. Yes. The rainbow represented the promise of God. And when God made that rainbow, it was what? It was good. Mm-hmm. And what do? We prostituted it out.
Yes.
We took the rainbow and we prostituted that rainbow to represent something else. So now we are in the generation where everything lines up with the word of God, including the manipulation of the rainbow. You see it everywhere now. So I told God, I said, God, so what do I do with this? I said, you know what? I know what I'm going to do. I said, simple. I said, God, train me the way you trained Noah. Train me the way you trained Noah. And so that's how things was going for the last part of 2021. And I was pushing in that area. All of a sudden, things start happening on the property. You know, I got excited again about gardening because I need to provide for the family. And I'm not just talking about our family. Our immediate family, we will provide for our immediate family. But also, I'm like, God, I need to provide for church family too. I need a garden where I can take care of my immediate family. But if someone's out there in need, I want to be able to provide for that person. I want to be able to help that person. So now we have two gardens, gigantic. Well, in my eyes, they're gigantic. Okay, for a guy who lived in a city and never gardened anything. These are two big gardens. I'm learning how to make compost. We have chickens, and now we have rabbits, and now we have seven rabbits. And one blink of an eye, I started with two rabbits. 30 days later, I'm like, I think she's having a baby. Whoa, she's having babies. Now we have seven rabbits. And so all these things are starting to happen. God is starting to show me things and training me up like he trained Noah. Okay? And as he trained Noah to do things, that's what he's doing with me. And so I don't want to get too far ahead, but we need to be prepared. We need to prepare ourselves. I'm not trying to fear monger. I'm not trying to build you into a frenzy of fear. But in Proverbs 22:3, and you can put that, oh, he already did. He's already joking. It says, a prudent person foresees danger and takes precaution, but a simpleton goes blindly and suffers the consequences. All right, this was just added in today because of the fact that I could see, you know, I feel like, okay, God, you're making me prudent. You're showing me what I need to do. But then there's others that sit there and say, you know what, brother? I'm believing that God's going to take care of me. And that's perfect. I believe that too. I believe God's going to take care of me. God's going to take care of you. But the prudent person is taken care of by God. And even the simple could be taken care of God. Because if we sit blindly, what happens? Well, we go through life. And You know, we ask God for provisions, and guess what God does? God provides. All right, I'm going somewhere with this. I don't know where, but I'm going somewhere. So I look back in the days of Joseph. Joseph was brought from the pit to the palace. And now he's second in command of all of Egypt. And a famine is coming. He was prudent, and he prepared for a seven-year famine. Am I right? He was prudent and was preparing for a seven-year famine. The Israelites were in their land. They were prudent. They did prepare for a famine. But here's the difference. Joseph never went without. When he was hungry, he ate. When he wanted something, he got it. Israel was in a spot. Their faith in God was there. And they said, Father, we are hungry. Feed us. Okay, I'm going to take care of you. I need you to pack everything up. I need you to go to Egypt. I need you to wait in the food lines. I need you to stay there. And when you finally get an opportunity to stand before Joseph, give him the offering, pay for the food, and then take it all and bring it all back to your household. And don't eat it all at once. Take your time and spread it evenly so you have enough. They were taken care of. So what I'm trying to say is this, a prudent person foresees danger and takes precaution. So that's what some of us are doing. And then the simpleton, which is still a Christian, he goes blindly because God's just going to provide every day. Every day I'm going to have manna. Every day I'm going to have manna. Eventually the manna stops. And the simpleton goes blindly on and suffers the consequences. God will provide for you, but it'll be in a different way than those that are prudent and are taking care of themselves. Everyone see where I'm trying to go at? I'm not saying that one is right and one is wrong. But what I'm saying is your mindset, your spirit, your relationship with God will determine how God will take care of you, how God will prepare for you for all of that. And I think the message says it, the Message Bible says it best. A prudent person sees trouble coming and ducks. A simpleton walks blindly and is clobbered. I love that. I love that because, you know, we see it and we pray. And I know I'm just praying God's hand over all of this. You know, God's going to take care of all of this. He's got this. He's got, yes, you're right. God's going to provide for me. Yes, he will. But he's going to provide for you in the way that you have prepared. If you need food, he will provide for you. You may have to go a long distance to get it. You see? Okay. So I said all that to get to the story, because this whole story is about a rooster that tried to kill me. Okay? The story I'm about to share with you guys is a true story. If you don't know what happened, this is a true story. And today, if it makes you want to laugh, do so. Because I have a thing about me. The way I deal with stress and pain, I do it through humor. I wasn't ready for that, brother. Don't jump ahead of me. I told him, I said, we're gonna link today. I'm like, the link has been cut already. So understand that I do things differently. And matter of fact, Karen, when I went to the doctor, when I went to the hospital and they rolled me into the room, she was behind me, and she whispered in my ear, don't be funny. Because she was like, they need to know this is serious. And so I ended up not saying a word. I mean, that was horrible. So here we go. I want you to hold on to this thought right here. This thought. It's called the law of multiplication. Hold that thought. The law of multiplication. And here's the example I want to give to you. If you took a single penny and you doubled it every day for 30 days, how many pennies do you think you'll have? Don't answer that. I'll answer it for you. If you take a single penny and you double it every day for 30 days, you will end up with $5,368,709.12. Okay? That's if you take a penny. That's the law of multiplication. You see, today I have a penny, tomorrow I have 2 pennies, the third day I have 4 pennies, the next day I have 8 pennies. And at first, you know, you go 10, 15 days in, it doesn't seem like the pennies are adding up. But once you start getting closer to the 20, then the pennies start doubling. And then you start seeing seeing this multiplication thing really starting to take off. Once you get to 25, then it's like millions are starting to flip, all right? So law of multiplication. I need you to hold on to that thought, okay? So back on February 13th, 2022, I went outside to feed my chickens. And I was out there and I turned around. When I turned around, Einstein, he's not very smart anymore. Einstein, the rooster, looked at me. I was like, what are you looking at? And I stepped. And when I stepped, he did ninja all over my knee. He jumped up and bam, bam, hit me twice. It felt like I got hit by a hammer in the knee. And I was like, you're not going to see me limp. I told that chicken, you're not going to see me limp. I'm walking out of there. I'm like, man. And I'll walk back to the house, right? Now you can show the picture. That is the spur that got me in the knee, right? That little spur, right? The law of multiplication. The second that spur hit my knee, bacteria started multiplying, okay? Stay with me on that. There was a bacteria that started multiplying. Now, how do I want to tie that in? I want to tie it in like this. The day you come to Christ, or the day you find out the calling in your life, the law of multiplication starts happening in your life. You start seeing the enemy trying to manipulate that. The enemy tries to pollute that. And at first, you don't feel it because you see, I got spurred and I went about my day like it was just a hammer to the knee. But the truth of the matter was there was already a battle for my life that's already started in my body. The white blood cells start trying to attack back, and the bacteria is fighting the same. And so there's a law of multiplication that happens in the spirit realm in your life. When you come to Christ, you may walk away feeling a little different, like God just touched you. When you get delivered from something, you might feel it, yes, God delivered me. But there becomes instantly the law of multiplication in the spirit realm to beat you up. The enemy's coming to get you, and the angels are trying to save you. And depending on how quickly you can get to the antibiotics of God will determine how quickly the bacteria can be eradicated. Everyone's with me on that?
Yeah.
So the law of multiplication is happening right now. So at 9 o'clock, I get spurred in the leg. And I go inside. I said, Karen, the rooster spurred me. I said, look, I got blood. Well, let's give me a rag. Clean it off. I got to get to church. I was really mad at the rooster, mainly because he cut a hole into my good jeans. And then I came here and I showed Frank and them. I said, look, he cut my jeans. 10:45 service starts. We do the countdown. I'm fine. And Sister Sylvia even says it on Facebook. You know, it didn't look like nothing was bothering you. And so I was fine. I refused to limp. I have a high tolerance to pain. A high tolerance to pain. And it was hurting, but I refused to limp because limping means someone's going to ask you which wrong. Okay? And so I refused to limp. 11:30, worship ended. We come down. I come down the steps. I go behind the camera and I start filming Pastor. Law of multiplication starts happening. While Pastor's preaching, y'all don't know this, but my leg starts throbbing. And so I'm sitting there just rubbing my leg during service. And then I stand up every once in a while so I can just like try to flex it. Because the way I deal with pain, I try to numb it. You know, I want it to hurt so I can make it a little numb so I can be comfortable. That's just me. Okay, so it's getting to the point at the end of service where it's unbearable. I mean, I told Pat, I was begging God, please let Pastor say amen and dismiss. And so I was almost looking back to grab Kobe to come up here and take over the camera because I just couldn't take the pain anymore. The pastor said amen. I turned off the camera. I said, I need to go to the bathroom to check what happened to my knee. I said, something's going on. That's when I noticed I started limping. And it was, I couldn't not limp. I had to limp. It was hurting at that point. So I go into the bathroom and I'm looking at it. I'm like, everything looks fine. Everything looks fine. Isn't that your spiritual world right there? I mean, on the outside, everything just looks fine. But something inside, something's just wrong. Yeah. Something's wrong. It's like the enemy is just coming against me. And so everything is fine. And so I said, I got to tell Pastor I got to go because normally I lock up everything. And I come And when I come out of the bathroom, the limp is even worse. Now, I'm not just limping like this, because this is what I was doing when I went to the bathroom. When I came back from the bathroom, I'm like this. I couldn't extend the leg any further, and I was just limping. I told Pastor, I said, I got to get out of here. I got to go. I got to get home. I got to go get ibuprofen. And by the time I get to the truck, I get into the truck. I am pulling my leg into the truck. It's hurting that bad. And so I start heading on out. I get to the end of the driveway. At this point, my whole leg is throbbing, right? I head on down. I get to right before the turnabout. I call Karen. I say, Karen, I said, I don't know what's going on. I'm heading home, and I need you to get home. And at that point, I actually told her. And she goes, how bad is it? I said, Karen, I feel like crying. I just feel like crying. Okay? So I called Karen. Okay, and then when I got to the turnabout, now hold on to this one. When I got to the turnabout, I wanted to come back to the church because it was closer than the house. And I was getting a little worried at this point. But I had to press forward to the house because Rusty gave me a rabbit that I had to get in the refrigerator. And I was like, I'm going to keep going. I got to get to the refrigerator. I got to put this in the refrigerator. Well, I got halfway up Block of Road where the pain was so unbearable that I had to pull over to focus on my breathing. And that's where I passed out. I passed out the first time. And when I came to, my vision was pretty much gone. Only thing I could see white. The road was grayish white. And the grass and the trees, they were greenish white. So I could still see color, but it was mostly white. And so I was like, I need to go. I need to get home. This rabbit is going to spoil in my truck, and I'm not going to have it. It's not going to happen. I'm not going to let it happen. So I get to 6 Mile Road, and I turn. At this point, everything is just turning white. It was just too much. I couldn't drive at all. I pulled over, and before you know it, that's where Karen's knocking on my window. Gene, wake up. Gene, wake up. And so it took a minute, and I just want to make sure it took a minute. I woke up, I rolled down the window, and she said, Gene, are you okay? You okay? I said, yeah, I'm fine. She goes, Gene, you're sweating, and your skin, Gene, your skin is yellow. And I looked, I'm like, Karen, I'm Asian. I said, and she was like, ugh. She goes, look, leave the truck here, jump in the car, and let's take you to the hospital. I said, I can't. The rabbit's in the back seat. I said, just follow me home, I'm fine. And so she grunted. And she got in the car, she followed me to the house. And when I pulled up, I mean, 5 feet from me. And I opened the door, she goes, get in the car. I said, just get the rabbit. I wasn't moving until she did, so she did. And it took me, at this point, it was just 5 feet. I couldn't do it. I thought I was doing it. It turns out later, I found out that Jan showed up at the house too. She was helping me to get into the car. It was just that bad. I just don't even remember Jan being there until afterwards. So Karen drives me to the hospital the whole time in Hazelhurst. I'm screaming. This is beyond comprehension for me. I couldn't focus on it. I couldn't pinpoint the pain. At this point, I'm screaming. We get to the hospital. When we get there, I'm trying to pull myself out. The nurse comes out with a wheelchair, and she says, What happened? I said, I was at 9 o'clock this morning. I got spurred in the leg by a rooster, and then all of a sudden, at the end of service, this happened. And so she's bringing me in, and she tells them, we're gonna take them right into the emergency room. So we go in there, and she comes around the corner, and I'm just in pain. I'm like, at this point, I'm trying not to scream and show my feminine side, but I'm like grunting and I'm growling and it hurts so bad. And the doctor says, What happened to him? And the nurse said, a chicken pecked him. I said, No, what do you mean? I said, a rooster spurred me, a big rooster. The spurs were like 5 inches long and it jabbed me in the knee. He didn't peck me. I mean, look at the size of the spur. I'll pull it back up. I mean, 5 inches. Look. Okay. All right. Listen, there was bacteria on the edge of that thing. It was lethal. Okay. It was lethal. Let's just go with that. So The doctor, they bring me into a room. Now, they must be having a bad day because everybody has an attitude, and you can't have an attitude around me. And especially if you're about to save my life. And they all seem to be bickering about stuff. You know, the waiting room is full, and then all of a sudden you get this guy in here, he got pecked by a chicken, and he's, you know, the world seems to be coming to an end. And so the nurse is there. There's several nurses, and they're taking off my shoes, and they try to take off my pants, and I scream. I said, stop. I said, stop. Y'all got to do it slower. Not in a sexy kind of slow, but just slower, please. Slow down. And they slowly started taking off my shoes and everything. And then when we got the pants down below the knee, the doc, he moved the band-aid and he saw that little hole. And I'm like, it's serious. It's serious. And they didn't understand how bad it was getting. It was just, okay, we're going to have to get you. Oh, and that statement right there broke the ice. I'm telling you, it broke the ice. It's almost like the whole staff in the operating room, emergency room, they were fine. Everyone had a personality again, okay? And so I give God the glory for that, because I was actually prepared to put everything back on, crawl into the car and say, take me to Brookhaven. I mean, I would rather die halfway to Brookhaven than have this crew touching me anymore. I mean, that's how I felt. So they took me to go get a CT scan, and they brought me back to the room. And I'm still, this is probably an hour in, nothing. They haven't given me anything yet. And so I'm just sitting there. So I started giving God the simplest prayer that I could ever think. And the guys, listen, the simplest prayer was, Lord, please help me. Lord, please, please. And it was under my voice. It was grunt, and there was pain in it. And so the nurse comes in, and she goes, how can I help you? I said, punch me in the jaw. Just punch me. Put me out. I need to be put out. I said, this is unbearable. She goes, I have morphine. And then with the clarity of my mind, I said, give it to me. Give it to me. I don't even know how it works. Give it to me. And she injected it in my IV. And I'm sitting up there. I said, how long does it take? How long does it? It should be working soon. I said, no. When is it going to? Yeah. She's like, how you feel? I said, I feel all the pain, but I don't care. I don't care. And then I started asking everybody, and no one had the answer. I was like, hey, who invented morphine? I want to give to that cause. You know, the doctor didn't even know who invented morphine. But it was that morphine that made it comfortable. And they started giving me antibiotics, okay? So once they started giving me antibiotics, they started monitoring me, and the swelling started to go down. So they felt good about that. And so they thought the next best thing to do is send them home. And so they sent me home. And so it was hard to walk. I couldn't walk. You know, I couldn't walk without a crutch. When I first got there, I'm walking to the house, and Mr. Tim and Miss Bonnie, that's Karen's parents, they were all, the whole family was sitting on the porch waiting for me to get there. Now, if you know Mr. Tim and Miss Bonnie, they both have canes and everything, and they walk around. And so I'm coming up to the step, and Miss Bonnie says, oh, he needs a cane. And she rips it from Tim, hands it to me. Tim is like, whoa. And I'm like, thank you. And so I eventually get into the room, and that's where I sit. I'm not even allowed to move at that point. And I couldn't move. I mean, I couldn't even slide my foot under the covers. I couldn't touch it. It just all hurt. Monday morning comes, and here we go. Monday morning comes, and I wake up, and I'm sitting there, and Karen goes to bring Carly to school. And when she goes to bring Carly to school, she says, now, you don't get up. I said, oh, okay, I won't. I won't get up. She goes and brings Carly to school. First thing I do, I get up. And I'm walking around the house with crutches because I got to take care of rabbits. I got a garden. I couldn't make it to the chickens. But I actually climbed the steps to go check my garden. Worst thing I should have done. I never even told her that. Her face is like, what? I told her I went and checked the rabbits. I never told her I went and checked the garden. By the time I came back down from upstairs in the loft, I realized this this was stupid and I shouldn't have done it. And I'm regretting it already. And so I get back in bed. At this point, I'm praying to God. And I'm like, God, I've been praying that you would raise me up like Noah. You would train me in the way that Noah went. Lord, I feel like now I'm not going to be able to do it. My leg, I'm going to always have some kind of Jacob limp. You know, Jacob wrestled with God and he got a limp for the rest of his life. I was thinking, how am I going to do all this stuff? How am I going to be able to keep up with the homestead? How am I going to be able to be like Noah if I can't do this? And you know what? I even called Pastor and shared this with him. I felt God even tell me, he goes, Gene, and I love it when he calls me by name. Don't you love it when he calls you by name? He said, Gene, Noah took 120 years to build a boat. Do you not think he bumped the knee, hit his head, slammed his finger, you know, dropped the board, twisted the knee, hurt his back, was sick? You think 120 years, none of that happened to him? He goes, trust in me, keep your faith strong, and keep moving on. And I told him, I said, God, I shared this with the youth one time. I said, God, it's hard to be Noah when it hasn't rained yet. Okay? It's hard to be Noah when it hasn't rained yet. And so I was finding myself having to just trust God that this is all going to work out for his good. So later that afternoon, the swelling started coming back. The antibiotics wasn't working. The swelling started to come back. And so we went to go see Dr. Irving. And while we were there, he decided he wanted to do a biopsy on my knee, which I've never done a biopsy on my knee. And I will punch somebody in the face if they ever say they got to take fluid out of my knee again. Because there is nothing worse than having a 16-gauge needle thrust into the side of your knee, and you could feel them sucking the fluid out. And as he's sucking it out, he goes, oh yeah, this is bad, this is bad. And I'm like, I'm telling you guys, it's an unbearable pain. They said, the first shot, he goes, I'm gonna give you something to kill the pain before we do the needle. And he says, it's gonna feel like a bee sting. It felt like 20 bee stings in one spot. That's how painful that part was. But when he stuck the needle in, I didn't feel the bee stings anymore. I felt everything else, okay? So he did that, and he was very concerned at the fact that he said, this has definitely got bacteria in it. We're gonna send it off, and we're gonna get it checked. You may have to have operation on your knee. Wednesday comes, and the doctor calls up, and Dr. Irving says, yes, there's bacteria there, and he's thinking it's septic. And so, you know, when Karen walks out of the room, I start looking up septic on Google. And man, it's horrible. It's horrible. It gets in your blood, kills you. If you don't get it dealt with, you lose something. You lose legs. You can lose parts of your body. And I'm like, days of Noah, Lord. Days of Noah. Days of Noah. So the doctor said, I need you guys to head to St. Dominic's for emergency knee surgery. And so we get in the car. I call my daughter. I call Pearl, and I said, Pearl, it's going to happen. She already knows that the possibility of knee surgery is happening. And I called her up. I said, it's going to happen. We're heading to St. Dominic's now for knee surgery. And she said, Dad, I pray that everything goes well with the procedure, with the operation. And I told her, I said, Pearl, I'm believing that there's nothing there and the operation is not even needed. And you know what she said? Sure, Dad. Sure. I said, that's what's going to happen. There's nothing there and I'm not going to need it. 3:30, we get to St. Dominic's. And then by 11:30 that night, they finally get me in. In the process of the 8-hour wait, they took blood from me. Everyone's taking blood from me at this point. They took blood from me. And by 11:30, we finally got to go to the emergency room and wait in the emergency room. And so from 11:30 to about 1 o'clock, we were in the emergency room. And in the emergency room, they gave me a fourth antibiotic. And they kept taking more blood out of me. And she took this one. She goes, I need to take blood. I said, I don't know. I ain't got any more veins. I ain't got any more veins. And so she said, oh, you got one right here. And so she stuck that needle in there, and it hurt. It hurt. But it was after she did that. Actually, that was my IV, too. I think they put my IV there. And I'm sitting up there, and I could just feel my heartbeat in my wrist. And I'm like, I said, Karen, this is going to drive me crazy all night if I'm not going to be able to rest. So I asked the nurse, can you give me a painkiller? And she goes, yes, we'll get you a painkiller. So I'm waiting for the Tylenol, because that's all I needed. I just needed something just to take that pain away. I'm waiting for Tylenol. And they come in, and they what was it? She put this stuff in me, and I'm like, oh, I feel it in my chest. Oh, man, I feel it in my throat. Oh. Oh, I feel it. I feel it. And then I told Karen, I'm sorry. Everyone's been left behind because I'm flying with Jesus. And y'all all missed the rapture. And I was just there. I was there, and the pain was gone. So at 1 o'clock, they brought me to the room. And the nurse came in and talked to Karen. And I'm just laying there. I'm feeling good. She decides, well, we forgot to take one more blood sample. And so she's taking more blood. I said, what do y'all do? I said, when y'all have junkies in here. And she's telling me all this stuff. And she said, you know, junkies even between the toes. They inject between the toes. I'm like, really? I said, that's got to hurt. Said, but it doesn't matter to them. They want it. And so they actually inject between the toes. And the doctor, the nurse keeps saying to Karen, yes, they're going to have to go in. They're going to have to go in and take all of this out. They're going to have to operate on his knee. The doctor will operate on his knee. And I was thinking to myself, you are not the final authority in this. You are not. You're a nurse. And you are not the final authority. And so the doctor that was on call on that floor, she comes in and she sits down on the couch and Karen and I, they're talking back and forth. And she said up there, yes, I look like it's looking like they're going to have to go in there and operate on a knee. And I'm thinking, well, she's a doctor, but she's not the orthopedic doctor. So you are not the final authority in this. You're not the final authority. At some point during the night, the shift changes. And so another doctor comes in. And this doctor, now this is every 15 minutes now. Sleeping is just not happening. But doctor comes in, and what happened, explained the whole story to him again. And she said, you know what, the orthopedic doctor will be in sometime in the morning. But I'm going to let you know, they're probably going to operate. And because they got to get this bacteria out. They start talking back and forth about what septic does and all this, la, 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 la. And I'm like thinking to myself, you are not the final authority in this situation. And I'm believing what I told Pearl, that they're not going to find anything and everything's going to be fine. And I said, you're not the final authority in this. And I'm just ignoring this whole conversation. I'll let Karen and the doctors and the nurse, they go to town, and I'm just thinking, I ain't having it. I ain't having it. And then 10 o'clock in the morning, an Asian doctor walks in. And I'm like, he's the one who's going to give it to me right. He was the orthopedic doctor. And he came up and he said, okay, I've been looking at everything. Your bacteria is, the bacteria count is 1,500. He goes, it has to be over 5,500 for us to even operate. It's not even, we're not even going to operate because it's not at risk. The antibiotics that they're giving you seems to be working, and so your numbers are at 1,500. And so I said, so you're saying no operation? He goes, no operation. I'm like, I knew it was going to be an Asian that does this. So 1,500, the bacteria count is at 1,500. It's going down, so there's no operation. He said, we've been taking blood. Your blood is normal. Your white blood cells are normal. And he says, we're going to release you. You're going to go home. And I was like, yes, Lord, yes, no operation, antibiotics, and that's all it was. And you know what? When I started getting up, I had to go to the bathroom. I realized the pain was already lessened. And I called Pearl. I said, Pearl, no operation. She's like, what? I said, no operation. The blood is good. The white blood cells are back to normal. The body has won. Guys, when you get into your ministry, when you get into your calling, and the enemy is just multiplying his attack on you, if you just hold the faith, hold the strength, stand firm, be still, and trust in God, and let your faith be the white blood cells flowing through your body, the enemy will be defeated in your life. But you need to hold your faith. There was times that I could have sat there and just given up, and I heard doctor after doctor, from Dr. Irving all the way up to that third doctor up there, all say the same thing, that you're going to need surgery. And it didn't happen. It didn't happen. And hold on to your ministry. Hold on to your calling. Because, you know, there's going to be a day when everything about this world, everything that's going on in this world is going to pass away, guys. We're not going to have to face this stuff anymore. We're not going to have to face the Ukraine crisis, the supply chain. You know, we have truck drivers from three different locations of the United States heading to Washington, D.C. to protest all this stuff that's going on. Do you not think that's going to affect our lives? It will. And there's going to be a day when everything about this world is going to pass away. But before God can do that, I almost missed my model now. Before God can do that, he has to deal with Satan first. Because like in the back in the garden, Adam and Eve sinned. And when God came to visit, he skipped over Adam, he skipped over Eve, and he went and dealt with Satan first. And that's what's going to happen in Revelation chapter 20, verse 10. And this is what John says about it. He says, "And the devil, who had deceived them, was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur, and where the beasts and the false prophets were, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever." God is going to have to deal with that first, okay, before we see this all passing away. In verse 14, after he deals with Satan, after he deals with the devil, then he goes on to death and Hades, and they were thrown into the lake of fire to be tormented. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And then once he gets to that, then we look at chapter 21, verse 4. Guys, then we get to a point in our life where he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And death shall be no more, neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore. Anymore, guys. Whatever we're going through right now, it's going to come to pass. We're going to be in heaven, and it's going to be never again. Isn't that worthy to praise God for? I mean, there's going to be a point where depression and anxiety and sin and bigotry and hatred and just the sin life that we live right now is all going to come to pass. And there will be no more weeping. And every tear from their eyes. And death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain. Guys, we all deal with pain, but it's going to go away because the former things have passed away. There's going to come a point. Everything you're fighting for, everything you're living in your life right now, it's going to come to an end. And as long as we continue to fight with the antibiotics of God and stay in that word and stay pressed in, when the enemy pushes you up against that wall, you can stand firm because it's coming to an end. Look at someone saying, coming to an end. Isn't that great? We are going to be in heaven, and we're going to be able to sit there and rejoice because the numbers, Dean, is going to be right. The knee is going to be right. The mind is going to be right. Everything is going to be right. We'll never have to worry about that. And it'd be instant because infinity, there was no beginning. There's no. When this all happens, it's going to be as if we were always there. We're not even going to have a timeline. Oh, man, I remember just yesterday. No. We're in eternity. It's instant. We lose all concept of time because we're in the presence of God. So that's encouraging. But I want to take you real quick back to the roundabout. Okay? And then we'll close it with this. Get to the roundabout. I had a decision to make at the roundabout. My decision was, I could turn back and head to the house of God, or I could continue my way and do it in my own strength. Guys, when I got to the turnabout, the pain was so unbearable in my left leg. I was already screaming, literally. Guys, listen, screaming. When I turned onto Blocker Road, the law of multiplication was hitting me so hard that my entire body was being tormented. I mean, guys, there was a torment that was happening in my body. I couldn't focus on it. I couldn't pinpoint it. I felt like everything was being ripped out. Every time I thought I felt pain here, I felt pain there. And when I can hear the screams of me screaming in my own mind. I can hear in the back of my mind me crying out, "This is how I'm going to die." Guys, it was to a point where I couldn't hold a clear conscience, a clear thought. I couldn't focus on anything. I couldn't focus on the pain. I couldn't focus on the location. It was just ripping me up all over my body to the point where I passed out. And it wasn't until that afternoon when I finally got the morphine and things got under control. But to that point, God, there was a tearing. I wish I could describe it. The way the inside of my body felt, the way the outside of my body felt. There was a ripping and there was a torment that was happening to me. And I just thought to myself afterwards, I'm like, if hell is 100 times worse than this, then Lord, help us to help others. Because I'm talking to a church body that will never have to face that kind of torment. You see, God is going to come back, and he's going to deal with the devil, and he's going to put him in a lake of fire to be tormented day and night. God is going to come back, and he's going to deal with death and Hades and put them in a lake of fire so they can be tormented day and night. But in Revelation 20, verse 15, if anyone's name was not found written in the book of life, he was thrown into the lake of fire and was tormented day and night forever and ever. God didn't do that part. God put Satan and God put death and God put Hades there. Guys, if we're not right with God, we put ourselves there. We put ourselves there. Now, there are some that believe that once saved, always saved. And in a twisted way, and hear me out, I believe once saved, always saved. But God gives you a choice. He doesn't determine that you're not saved anymore. You determine to walk away from that. You make a decision to walk away from that. And because you make that decision, you can't blame God, because he said, nothing can pull you out of the hand of God. Nothing. Not even Satan himself. But you have the free will to walk away from it all. And to have the arrogance to sit there, walk away from the grace, the mercy, and the healing power of God, and walk away in your ignorance to think, I'm still saved. You are the foolish one in the Bible. Guys, God is a powerful God. But when he created us, he created us to make a choice. He gave us an opportunity to choose whether we're going to serve him or not. And if we choose to serve him, he holds you in his right hand. And nothing can take you away from that. But you have no right to try to blame God because you walked away from it. You can't blame God because you walked away from it. I felt the torment in my body that had me fearful for my own kids, fearful for the students that that are under me in this ministry, fearful for members in the church that live religion and come to church. Come to church and sit and do your Bible, do your church time. I felt the torment in me that I couldn't explain. I never want to feel that torment again. And you know, the scary thing is that we will be in heaven rejoicing. But the whole time we're rejoicing, I really feel, and I don't know, but I really feel Jesus crying because of that one that's not there. We're rejoicing. But I really think Jesus is going to be crying over those that are tormented for all eternity. A torment that's real, guys. Don't think you know the mind of Christ and say, you know, God loves me. I'm gay. God loves me. I'm bisexual. God loves me. I'm doing drugs. God loves me. I'm watching porn. God loves me. God's a loving God. God's a judging God. And the only thing we have for our protection is the righteousness that he gives us. That is our righteousness. Guys, we need the Lord. And we're in a time right now that many will be deceived and many will fall away with the arrogance to believe God's got my back because he loves. We need the Lord. You need the Lord. And then you need to ask God to put on the hearts of those that are not saved to minister. It's time for us to put our priorities in order. We allowed our generation, I'm talking about the kids, we allowed our kids to choose whether they wanted to go to church or not. We allowed our, 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 We allow our homes right now to make a choice. Hey, do you want to watch the football game or do you want to do this? Do you want to go to church? It's raining. Do you want to go to church today or not? And we've relaxed on that priority.
Amen.
Guys, we have got to get real because this is a real reality. This is the reality God created for us. So this is the reality we live. And in this reality, are there going to be hard times? You know what? We are raised in hard times right now. This is a hard time. And we need the Lord.
Yes.
Do you believe that we need the Lord?
Yes.
Stand with me. We're going to do this one exit song.